If I can get everyone's attention, we'll go ahead and get started. It's about 5:40, and we have publicized this meeting to get started about 5:30. So we'll go ahead and get started as people come in and just join us. First of all, I want to thank you all. Thank you for coming to this meeting tonight. My name is Jeremy Blake. I'm a member of North City Council representing the 2nd Ward. We have other officials in the room. Alex Roletta is a member of council representing the 4th Ward. Our fire chief is here, Pat Connor. As I'm going across the room, IAFF Union President Dave McElfresh is here with us. Council President Don Ellington is here with us. Councilman Mark Guthrie at large is here with us. In the back, we have Councilman Cost, at-large member. Councilwoman Carol Floyd is here from 7th Ward, and then the 1st Ward Councilwoman Dee Hall is also in the back there. Are there any other city officials that I may have missed? Basically, we wanted to give some little background. You know, I think it's important for us as elected officials to get input from stakeholders. And many times through things that happen on Monday evenings, we don't necessarily get feedback from everybody who's a stakeholder. We obviously hear proposals and information from the city administration, and then we obviously get information from the union, from the IAFF representation. But we, after the last public discussion, that personnel committee meeting, I think many of us left that room feeling like there's got to be more information. There's got to be more comments. There's got to be more inputs that needs to be gathered. And so I was very pleased, actually, that we had tabled the legislation to August 10th regarding the mayor's proposal for the part-time firefighters. Tabling that legislation did give us time to communicate with our constituents, to continue the community dialogue that needed to exist on any type of controversial piece of issue that's related to us. I mean, I talked to Don Ellington, who served on the school board just as I did, and I lived through the Randy Storch days when I was on the school board, and so I've been through many controversial situations, and a lot of times it's just about going back to the community and opening up for the community to talk and to express their opinions about what's happening within our great city. And so I just want to say thank you for coming here tonight. You've taken time out of your evening to express an interest in city government, specifically the fire department, and to talk about government services and to talk about what we can do as a collective discussion and collective voice in trying to provide direction for our community regarding the fire department. Tonight, I'm just going to really open it up for people to, you've read news articles from the Advocate, you've read news articles from the Dispatch, you've had conversations with different city officials, and so we're going to open it up really primarily for the residents and for the voters and taxpayers to express their opinions. The only real preamble that I'm going to give is that we know we've had an overtime issue within North Division of Fire for many years. I mean, I first got involved with community service back when Mayor Frank Stair was elected. And so even back then, the overtime issue was reaching $1 million, close to. And so now we're talking about maybe a quarter or so from last year. I think in 2014, it was $232,000 was overtime around there. And then, so it's much, much improved, but we're still things that we can do to make it even better. And then we also know that the East End station has been browned out because of staffing concerns. We've gone down to only calling in firefighters for overtime when we are down to 14. And I keep looking at the chief to correct me when I say something wrong. When I do say something wrong, just holler at me. And so the East End station has been effectively, with not being staffed, it's been closed because of not having staff there. And then just the issue of maintaining only 14 firefighters. That puts pressure on our employees, the great service that they provide, but also concerns to the residents because they are in high demand of their services. If they're having a heart attack or if they're having some type of ailment, they want to be able to call 911 and get the best response time possible. And so that 14 level is very concerning. But those are the issues that we have, this response time, the 14, the East End station being closed, the overtime issue. And, you know, we'll go, this is being recorded. Everett with the Licking County Computer Society, he comes every Monday night and records our deliberations at City Council. And so he's graciously come to this meeting to record this so that we have something to put on YouTube. And if you haven't seen some of the previous discussions, you can always go to the North City Council YouTube page and see previous discussions about how things have progressed through this discussion. You know, I will facilitate the meeting, and then if people, if you just want to raise your hand, and since we are being recorded, he has his microphone up there, so if you just really speak loudly and maybe even stand when you're speaking, that will help project your voice so that we do get it recorded. And then when solutions come up, and we really are looking for solutions, we really want good ideas about how we can work as a community, because this isn't just a Mayor Hall situation, or this just isn't a City Council situation. This is something that we as a community really need to digest and really to understand. We have a revenue issue here in the city. I mean, we really do. And how do we generate money to fund city services and things of that nature? So really want everyone to be involved. We want you to feel welcome. You know, when I was doing different activities within our middle schools and high schools, when I was in school board, I used a sort of an analogy. It was called ropes for different public events or different events within schools. And ropes stood for respect, openness, participate, pass, enthusiastic, and being supportive. And those are sort of the ground rules that I would just like to lay out for today, because we don't want to get into emotional debate of disrespecting people. We want people to feel as though they are free to share their opinions and free to express those opinions openly. And so just please keep that in the back of your mind that we want to be respectful of everyone here tonight. But Alex is, when we do have a good solution, the group feels as though we should put something up on the board, we're going to have Alex type that in, and hopefully at the end of the meeting we'll have a nice list of possible things that the city can look into and to possibly consider as to helping with this issue that we have within Division of Fire. And so, you know, if anyone feels the urge to want to begin, we'll go ahead and just get started. So, yes, please.
I
if you could just share your name when you say it.
Sure. Yeah. My name is Mary Reed, and I'm a citizen here in the city of Newark. And I have been for quite a long time. I remember 10 years ago, give or take, we voted for a fire levy. So as we're discussing revenue and how things are paid for, we voted for a fire levy, which my understanding at the time, maybe ignorant voter, but my understanding at the time that would be in addition to. Was it? Did it end up being in addition to? I've heard different things over time that what ended up happening was, yes, we used this money for it, and then other money was backed out of the budget. And so they really didn't get extra money or didn't get as much extra money as the people that voted for that levy thought they would get. So I'm just kind of curious what happens with that money now.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a great question. And others in the room can jump in to help continue the discussion. But the first thing that pops into my mind is that we also have to understand, and this really hasn't been a part of the narrative that has been published in the Advocate, but we really have to understand that we have lost millions of dollars from local government funds, from state government. We really have. I mean, it's been shifted from the cities have been hurt from losing that local government fund. We've lost the real estate tax. We've lost, I mean, there's been significant changes. And the chief can even say that, you know, our budget 10 years ago is totally different than it is today because we have lost some of those revenues. And so I know if others want to chime in and continue on and try to answer or continue to dialogue with that, but that's the first thing that I think needs to happen is that, and if Alex could even say so, is that we, the mayor and other elected officials, we need to go provide public testimony to the Ohio House, the Ohio Senate, on the effects of what decisions they're making in Columbus, how it affects Newark City Government Services. So Alex, if you wouldn't mind typing that one up as a suggestion that we need to be more, the elected officials in the city of Newark need to be more active in providing public testimony in Columbus. But I'll let others chime in on her comments as well. If someone else wants to chime in. Yeah, Mark.
I just sort of want to add on to the point you made, Jeremy. I'm Mark Guthrie. And that is because I think that it's important for all of us to connect the dots as to why we are in the jam we're in today. And Jeremy made the point about the cuts from state government. You know, we, ironically, The money that state government cut from us in the local government fund is money we sent there to start with. It's money that our residents and other residents of local communities in Licking County pay into the different funding sources that are divided up and sent back to local governments. To add insult to injury, not only did they take that money away, they took the state inheritance tax away, and they didn't do it. They did it overnight. So several hundred thousand dollars that cost the city. They're now talking about doing centralized collecting of income tax, which is going to cost our city. And the state lottery, which of course does help education, but it also was supposed to help local governments. It helps only the cities where the casinos are and the counties. So Licking County, they got in excess of $1 million to help offset their loss of local government fund, and the city of Newark got zero. So that, I just wanted to mention those other areas because it's a major hit that our city is taking, and you're absolutely right. There is and the public have a right, in my opinion, to be disgusted, because not only did the public approve that levy, city council passed EMS billing. So that's additional revenue. But if you really look at the big picture, pretty much all that money was eaten up by our loss of state revenue.
Does that help answer, help understand, Tony?
That answers maybe present day, but I still would like to know, and I don't expect anyone to be able to necessarily answer it right now, but I would like to know, how was that money used from the beginning? Because I have a sense, but I don't know for sure, I have a sense, at least initially, that it got, this is how much they're supposed to get, and so then some of the other money was backed out as opposed to being in addition to. And I just want to make sure I understand how that was used even back then. I should have paid more attention in the last 10 years, but, you know, until in the last couple of years, things seem to be fairly okay. And I do understand, as far as what you're saying, as far as the hits that the local governments have taken, I certainly wouldn't characterize my view as disgusted. Concerned, I think, is probably a better word, but I just would like to have a better idea of kind of historically what has happened with that money and, you know, what is happening with it now. Because that money should at least be going to the fire department. It couldn't have been eaten up by the other cuts. Perhaps extra money going to the fire department has been eaten up by the cuts, but that money is supposed to be going to the fire department. I just want to make sure that it is.
I think the issue of transparency within our finances is a huge
powering off.
I mean, we have had, I've been on council now for about a year and a half or so. It's my first term. And other cities have their financial information on the website or have their financial information in some type of easily accessible budget document. So that's something we most definitely should be improving upon, is making sure that you shouldn't have to always call the auditor's office to get information. You should be able to just go to our website and be able to pull up what data you need. So, and those types of queries, those types of information seeking things should be more easily accessible. So you're absolutely right.
That'd be wonderful. I bet that costs money too. Yeah.
Well, I mean, actually, just in finance committee a few weeks ago, we had the state treasurer come over and give a presentation where they provide the service for free. So the city auditor just has to provide the data, and the state treasurer uploads it into a system that they do. So, and you know,
that'd be fantastic.
That was kind of the reason why I brought them into the city hall that day. But let's get some other folks to. Did you want to make a comment? You got your hand up, Dave?
Yeah. I'm a senior like many people here in Newark, and have had a lot of sickness of one kind or another, and have valued the EMT firefighters who came to take care of me and get me to the hospital. And not just to say that they're wonderful people, that's a lot of people say that stuff, which they are, but it is that this kind of service to me is not a negotiable discussion. I mean, I don't see it as saying, well, how much should we cut it? I see it as, how much do we guarantee a service that is essential to people's lives? You know, a service that should be honored, respected, increased, not decreased. And I recognize the financial questions that people are raising, but it makes me furious that we don't prioritize service enough to guarantee that everybody gets who they need. And I also see going to part-time as being a decrease in service. I see any proposals for temporary workers or for reducing the minimum staffing or for, as somebody really burned me the other day by suggesting that maybe we should consider privatizing. And in every area of social service in this country, the push for privatization has meant that profit comes ahead of the service. I mean, we can't place service as a profit-making thing in this country. We shouldn't in Lincoln County. So anyway, I don't have room in my thinking for negotiating this question anymore. I say, you know, stop this insanity. Let's make sure that we have more than adequate staffing, you know, more than and full-time workers who see it as a career that they can look forward to, not a part-time employee who says, well, maybe I'll sacrifice, you know, maybe I'll give up part here. And I don't want to give up parts. I want better, more service even.
Donna.
I was quite the one counseling you, if I understood it correctly. Firemen, their equipment is being purchased, correct? Is there equipment for them personally to use?
The city purchased.
Yes. So right away, my thought was to even discuss having part-time. That's blowing money. I mean, we don't have money, obviously, to waste. So why would you want to invest in somebody who's part-time? And that person's not going to hang out. They're looking for a career. They're looking for a passion. They're looking for a home. This is like Lincoln Memorial. We said, we're going to cut half the staff, you know. That would never be a discussion. And I'm almost appalled it's even discussion to cut off some of this as far as fire department. I lost my entire house in 2000. And thank goodness for the fire department. When I was in a car accident 2 weeks ago, thank goodness that they were there for that as well. So if we start cutting that, then who gets injured? Who gets hurt when this happens? Or if somebody dies because we did not have enough staff to get somewhere, are we going to wait until then to say, oh, whoops, now we need to hire more people or get this covered? Mm-hmm. So that's just my opinion on it. I think it has to be about the people being safe and protected.
So Juan, just to continue with our list, so I'm hearing from both David and Donna, perhaps not only just looking at cost, but the quality of the service needs to be considered. So why don't we put quality of service of the fire, committing the fire. Would that be fair?
Yes, it needs to be consistent.
Okay. I'm recognizing that the quality of service that I've gotten and other people have told me about has been extremely high. And it's the quality of the firefighters and EMT workers. And but we want to maintain and improve that always. I mean,
the quality of a career-driven full-time fire division of fire versus having a part-time program. Don, or I'm sorry, Linda. No, I'll get you.
I also heard you say that the fire station in the East End, and for all intents and purposes, is no longer functioning. So which fire department then is taking those calls from both the East End and the South End of Newark? And how are response times affected?
Chief, you want to take
sure. I'm your fire chief, Patrick Connor. We do everything metric based. Everything we do is pulling numbers, looking at response times in the area, looking at emergencies in the area. All this information we do post on our website. We have a new website that we post that for you to see. So decisions that are made with our staffing levels currently are made with those in mind. The East End Fire Station and that East End area specifically that it covers has a lower call volume than an area we did not have a paramedic unit in. And In order to take the limited resources that I am able to afford today, which is 14 per day, I put those 14 people in the areas of most call volume currently. Is that a good situation? No. I want to have enough people to open all the fire stations. I think that as far as the south end of Newark, it's covered by our Newark Fire Station 1. The response areas in that district have always been very good. We are, obviously, with limited resources, busy. So those resources are tied up sometimes, and you have to wait for a resource from another fire station in town or a mutual aid truck coming from either Heath, Granville, Newark Township, or such. So I think there's a little bit of I want to clear up a little bit of information. Sometimes media might put something out there that might confuse some of you. The fact of the matter is I've met with council on more than a few occasions. We communicate by email with some documentation and some research that's been done. As a fire chief in this town, I want all full-time people. I'd like to have enough full-time people to cover the emergencies in town. However, there are only so many tax dollars right now that I have to use, and currently they're not enough to staff the levels that I would like to have. So what does that mean to me? That means that I have to look into ways of being more efficient with what we have. And when you do that, you make suggestions that potentially go against what labor might want or what some people in the community. But as many people are here, they're talking about, we all want more firefighters. I don't know any community that wouldn't, really. They cost money. And right now, revenue is down, as we've talked about already. There is only so many dollars to go around, and the general fund budget is significantly down over the last several years. The fire department specifically since 2010 has taken a $1.3 million cut in our budget alone. That's just in 5 years, $1.3 million, and we're still operating. That's kind of telling, to be truthful, very telling that we can continue to operate. But now we're seeing the effects of reduced staffing and community meetings like this to try to figure that out. I'm merely trying to find a solution to this problem. I'm not saying I have the tell-all solution to the problem, but we're presenting solutions. And I appreciate the meeting today because some of you have some great ideas. Hopefully someone comes forward with an idea that none of us have thought of. We are not perfect, but this is something we all think about every single day. We work very closely with everyone to find that. So that's where we're at right now.
I've got a question about the unionization of the firefighters. How many of you firefighters are here? Raise your hands, please.
Five.
Four. EMTs?
EMTs?
Yep. You've probably been to my house. Probably been to my grandmother's house. She's now deceased. So are you keep wanting to keep your union strong? Absolutely. Okay. My uncle had two boys. He's now deceased. I was his daughter that he never had. His name is Bill Wallenberg. He was the United Auto Workers. United Auto Workers, we represented Rockwell International. His name's on the plaque out there at the UAW Hall. My dad retired from Rockwell International, and anytime I get to speak about a union and the workers' rights that we don't have anymore than we need. I was 12 when I moved down to Anderson, South Carolina. And we know now that the Confederate flag is now down. And amen to that. Because this is a long and a historical moment about being treated as a subordinate, or being treated as a subordinate, or being sub below. When we talk about race, it's checked on, you know, they want to know your race or whatever. They don't put German, Italian. They want to know if you're Hispanic, non-Hispanic. We're nothing more than the human race. And so, to pay homage to him, he died right before his, he died 2 days before his birthday. We buried him on St. Patrick's Day. So he was appointed to an international committee on his obituary. So I apologize for my getting a little teary-eyed. So I had You guys knew my grandmother's address when she was a fall risk. She lived right behind the high school. I was her living caretaker. So what is, you want to keep the union strong, and yay for that, because no longer since capitalism and corporations have now, I have anxiety disorder, so pardon me,
taken over.
There you go, thank you. Taken over and stepped on, and we've trampled and trampled over the Constitution and so on and so forth. So I want to keep your union strong too. And it is about, I trust, put more faith in my pharmacy and the medics about pharmacopoeia than I do some of the doctors here in town. And so on. So I will say something at the end, so I can gather my thoughts here for a moment. But that, I am very for keeping the union strong, because you folks have families, wives, children. And if you want to put this thing on part-time, you want to think about putting someone, transplanting an organ donor from Columbus to here, this being life flight in for the Heath Airport. Think about that and these checks and balances of, you want to, it's the propaganda of trying to integrate the whole person. It's not about health care, it's about care for the health. And as we learn about sociology, I'm at the CATS campus, I'm in social work myself, so it's about having the advocacy, so I'm right here where I belong. And I see your statistics on your thing and in your treasury office and about numbers. I'm going to have to take a math course soon. Hopefully I won't push that to the tail end. But it is about, there's qualitative research and quantitative. And this is quantitative, what we're doing is quantitative with human interaction right now. It's called symbolic interaction and sociology class. So the more abstract thinking we have versus virtual interaction on the internet and so on and so forth. So I just wanted to put an emphasis on keeping your union strong while there is a union that is existing. We must keep that and embrace it and struggle to keep that intact. So right now that's about
all.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I think what you're saying, I think the people of Ohio agree with you, because they repealed Senate Bill 5, saying that public employees have the right to collectively bargain. Mm-hmm. So I think the people of Ohio have said that, and you know, we get bashed several times about, you know, why are we, how come the union is getting this, that, and other? Well, it's a process, and we support that process, is allowing them to be able to have that right to collectively bargain and negotiate with their employer. So that's something strong that I know I believe in, and you know, it's a reason that my beliefs align with others probably in this room. But I think the people of Ohio did say that too, and they agree with me. So, Janet.
I have a question really to the council members that are here. If there's a change in fire service, does that affect the city's insurance rates? If we don't have the kind of reliable, all-time, 100% Johnny on the spot, up to code fire protection, how will that impact our businesses and our residences in terms of not only our rates, but our desirability as a location for future growth? So I don't know the answer to that question, but I think it's something to ponder and to discuss with the administration. So I appreciate the input to that.
I'm thinking, do you want to absorb that, or does anyone want to try to respond to it, Janet?
I can respond directly. The insurance rates are evaluated every periodically through time, and they are measured by several different things in order a company comes in and measures how fast your response times are, how much water you can provide to certain buildings and all types of what equipment you carry on the trucks. And staffing is one of those things. To answer your question, yes, it could. It could affect that. But until they do those type of evaluations, you know, you stay with the same insurance rating. I believe they do it every 10 years, and you can request that as well to do it more. But some insurance companies are not accepting the ISO ratings. Some do, some don't. Some are getting away from that now. I think there was a news story recently in regards to that in Madison Township and what's going on out there right now. I think some of the residents had some of the similar questions in regards to that. So it can affect that. But until you have that evaluation, you don't know.
I'll get to you here in a minute, but the chief brought up our budget for this year, and Mark Guthrie and I met with the city auditor actually earlier today, and he and his deputy provided some information to us. Just a little education so everybody can sort of get on the same page. When council adopted the budget for 2015, this was the amount, this $4,618,000 was the amount that council budgeted for the Division of Fire, which is line item 5111. As of July 24th, we have spent about half of that, about $2,464,000 of that. The administration had transferred out of salaries and wages over to the overtime budget $100,000. So the remaining balance for this year is $2,053,991 approximately. That's what, as of July 24th, that's how much money is left in the salaries and wages budget. And so what the auditor has projected, and Mark, you were in that meeting, so you can help me if I'm saying something wrong, but what the auditor projected was that for the rest of this year, from going all the way through December, is that we're going to spend $1,800,700, and then at the end of the year there's a EMT pay that comes out, and so subtracting that from this $201,000 will be the projected end balance within salaries and wages for the Division of Fire. Now, what does this mean? Okay, hold on a minute, John. Let me get through this and I'll get right back to you.
This question on that paper.
Yeah.
Is that total budget or is that wages?
This is salary and wages. This is not total. This is not this total. So what that means, and Alex, if you could go over to the next tab at the top. Thank you. Keeping that in the back of our mind, that was salary and wages. Council approved $150,000 for overtime for 2015. We add in the $100,000 that was transferred from salaries and wages, which is now $250,000. And then here's what's interesting, and you know, you hear this number of 14 staff that the chief had talked about, that we're now, the only time that when they're calling someone in for overtime is when they get down to that number. In January, February, March, April, and May, you can see those figures at which were spent. If you look at the numbers, it appears as though it was in around the middle of May when that policy started getting implemented. Because you see the first pay in June was the $18,000, which is what it was for the previous pays. But then the overtime goes down to $3,200 in that June 19th pay. So would that be about the time when you went down to the fourth, not calling anyone unless there's, so you're seeing that right there. And then you see for July, you see $3,400 for the July 2nd pay, and then $3,500 for the July 17th pay, at which for the month, when we have a pay tomorrow for the month of July, for July 31st, and so that's going to add probably another approximately $3,500 in there. But you're seeing, due to the policy of going down to 14 and not calling anyone in, they have reduced the overtime number there. And now, going and just not projecting what decisions are going to be made for the rest of the year, because you haven't said anything and we don't know what you're going to do yet. So taking that $250,000, we only have $31,000 left in overtime. Is that correct?
That's correct.
That's correct. So I just wanted to share some data that we got from the auditor's office about this number. Mark, did you want to add anything about these numbers that you might want to project with people?
No, only that, and by the way, I want to say something about the chief. The chief didn't create the situation we're in today. And I personally am grateful that he's here tonight. But in our meeting last week in council chambers, the chief and safety director indicated that they felt that they may need $50,000 more transferred into the overtime account before the end of the year, right, Chief?
That's correct.
Okay, so that would then bring that one number down a bit. And the bottom line is, with the grant that we've received to hire three new full-time firefighters, potentially we could hire another firefighter or two before the end of the year. But then we have to start dealing with 2016 finances. And can I just share one thought, Jeremy?
Oh, yeah.
I just want to share that next year we go into contracts again. And to me, before we buy into the concept of bringing part-time service into our fire department, which, by the way, there's not a lot of evidence out there that it's good in the long term for communities. It really isn't. You know, you look at the PICWA study, and Beaver Creek in Southwest Ohio is a community that is going almost completely away. I think they'll be completely away from part-timers here very shortly. So there's not a lot of evidence out there. But it seems to me that we try to get as much staff on board as we possibly can, and then this becomes a part of negotiations next year with the fire department, between the administration and the fire department, and if necessary, a fact finder, a mediator, and if necessary, an arbitrator. But to me, these kinds of issues really are bargaining discussions that we really shouldn't have to have a public meeting about. It should be a bargaining issue under discussion. But of course, we need to have meetings about this.
Alex, let's go back to our Word document and add in that part-timers should be a part of the negotiations for 2016. That's what I think we should put up. Irene.
I have two questions. We are going to get three full-time firefighters with the SAFER grant. And there may be room in this budget to hire another full-time. First let me ask the first question because I don't know the answer to it. In the EMS revenue that comes in, it seemed to me that at one point, Licking Memorial was supplying the supplies for the medics, the medic units. You know, the gauze and bandages and those kinds of things. Is that still correct?
No, but when you start billing specifically, you must provide your own supplies. That has to become part of our budget to replace those.
I know they stopped for a time, but then I thought they started supplying them again.
They currently, Licking Memorial supplies for departments that do not do EMS billing, but departments that do, which are becoming almost all of them around us now. They replace. We have to purchase our own supplies here. So
there
we have
is a budget
plan for that.
And I wonder, you know, because when I was on council, it wasn't being utilized very well.
Right.
So
that's where we're at. We purchase all our own supplies.
So now that gets used up.
Correct.
The auditors told me there was $72,000 in that account now.
Yeah, we do purchasing in quarters in some cases, and we do high usage. All of our EMS coordinator is a captain. He managed that very well. It's easy to show a trend over the period of time we've been doing this. And he is very efficient as well as what we purchase to try to maintain. We'd like to try to spend as least amount of money as we can in order to have, we can also push that money in somewhere else if we get to use it. So, but that's where we're at.
Then that leads to my second question. Is if these, how soon can you hire these three firefighters? Because I think your president, David, said that you have a list.
We do. We have a current list. This past week, nothing moves fast enough for me in government. I think a lot of people can understand there's just a process that takes place. We're under civil service. So there has to be an email chain and phone calls and all these things that happen. It just doesn't happen very fast. So this week specifically, we're working very hard to ascertain who those people are going to be that we're going to hire. We have to call them. Are you still interested? Those types of things. Get them in here. And what we do is give them a conditional letter of employment. Then there's three other steps that they have to take: a physical, a psychological exam, and a, what am I missing? Polygraph. Correct. They pass all those things and they can be hired. So that takes a little bit of time and logistics to get that set up. But we are moving, we've had conversations every single day. I'm meeting with my staff to make sure this moves as fast as humanly possible, put those people on the street.
Do you have a time frame? I mean, given all that, how long will it take?
I hate to even throw one out there, but let's talk about a month and a half.
Okay.
That's a goal, that's a realistic goal.
Now, if you get those three folks on board, will it change these numbers of the overtime?
The SAFER grant is what, how those three...
Will it change your, because you'll have three more firefighters, yeah. That should...
You would add one more person to the shift. Will it reduce overtime?
Yeah.
A portion of it. I mean, very small, because the fact of the matter is we need a bunch of firefighters to eliminate overtime. And honestly, overtime in the fire service is never going to be gone.
Well,
every fire department, you can call tomorrow, call them all. Do you have an overtime line item? Yes. Everyone has that.
When I first started on council, the overtime was $900,000 a year.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And so I realized that's just part of the way the whole thing is set up.
Right.
But I would think that in addition to three more people, could make a dent.
It could make a small dent. That's one per shift, because we have three 24-hour shifts.
Yeah.
So yes, that could make. It always helps. If you want to give me one firefighter, I'll take it.
So if it reduces the overtime a little bit, would there be enough reduction in that overtime that you could hire, the city could hire one more firefighter?
That is discussion that is happening currently. Director Spurgeon, myself, mayor, everybody. Here's the thing, Jeremy from Updated Continue. Here's the thing that's concerning to me as chief. I have to not only look at what we have currently in the budget, what's been shown up there. Next year, we've got some things that we've got to worry about as far as the budget's concerned. We've got a 27th pay. That's an entire pay that we have to pay out of our budget that normally does not happen. It's probably, in my budget, $175,000. $170,000, give or take. There was raises that were contractual raises. I paid that out of that same budget. So when we get off, the problem is, until I know what next year is going to be allocated for me, I don't want to hire too many firefighters this year and have to lay them off next year. I have to know without a doubt that the people that I hired, I want to be able to retain them and keep them and not be able to have to lay them off. It's not really healthy to spend every dollar in your budget. You have to have some sort of buffer for an emergency. Right now, the fire department rainy day fund, unfortunately, is the personnel money. It is, if we have something happen. And that would, obviously, we'd use personnel money anywhere else besides personnel. The council would have to approve that. But it's my thoughts are your thoughts. We're talking every day. We're very responsive right now. We're talking about maybe grabbing an extra firefighter. Will that leave us enough money to get through the end of the year? And with overtime and all that, and then next year retain them, but not lay them off.
And if we're looking at $150,000 left in salary, and we're in July, so we're only looking at a half a year's salary then.
Correct.
A new person. So, but Alex, let's put those points up there. Hiring a firefighter out of the current general fund, and then the next item is the, as best we can, hire for the SAFER grant to help with the fire staff. I'll come to you here in a minute, but I'll get this gentleman who hasn't spoken yet. Yes, please.
I'm Jim Dumball. I live in the West End. I'm a retired fire chief from Granville. I had moved to Newark after I had retired from Granville. When that levy was up, I heard the lady say about 10 years ago, and I really can't remember what it was, but I went out and worked my neighborhood on my own, telling people that they needed to vote for the fire levy. That was my life too. My question is, that money that is still coming, and it's still the same amount, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
I heard that we had a decrease in funding by $1.3 million. That came from the loss of money from the state. Is that correct?
It comes from a number of different things. That is one of the things.
Why? Yes. How much of that money, council, how much of that money that we are taking in from this levy from 10 years ago, as I recall, it's a 25-year, am I right on that? Can anybody answer that, council?
I don't think it's got a sunset time.
I think it's permanent.
It's a permanent?
It's an income tax.
Okay. How much of that money then did we overspend on buildings? Three nice, really nice buildings. Did we overspend on that? Be honest. How much over budget? How much over budget was spent for two fire stations and a police station?
Good question.
When I went out and campaigned in my neighborhood, I campaigned for money to have firemen on duty. I could not run a fire department without manpower. And in Granville, I had more manpower than the city of Newark had. Think about it. Put it in your pipe and chew on it a little bit. Not good. Not good. You're overspent. So where does that leave us? It leaves us short of money. How are we going to get more money? If the people want more money, they're going to have to put a levy on to get more money to pay. And I'm willing to do that. Now, I understand that the property values in Newark are going like this. We got so many people in this town on welfare, and it's just keep growing and growing and growing. Right? Yes. That's hurting the dollars coming in so you can have money to pay these guys. Now, quit grinning. Because I want to get on you now. There's pride in the fire department. I'm proud that I was a firefighter. When we came in from a run, we backed that truck into the front of the fire station and it got washed. I'd be ashamed of my group if I seen some of the Newark fire trucks, like Newark fire trucks, look now, and squads, running up and down the road, covered in dirt, haven't been washed for a week. You need to work on that. You need to get pride back into the fire department, in my opinion. That's where I see the loss of pride. Pride, to me, makes teamwork. And teamwork gets the job done.
Thanks. Thank you. A few things I've heard from your comments was, Alex has put up asking, revenue generating, asking the voters of Newark for funds. I'm trying to summarize what else, some other possible solutions I've heard from the gentleman. I think the rest of them kind of administrator type thing. Yes, John.
Councilman Blake. John Priest, City of Newark. What provisions has the City of Newark gone out to raise business in Newark? Business brings in money. Correct? If I own a business, I'm going to pay taxes. The more bigger my business, the more taxes I pay. I do know for a fact, I have a friend who's a real estate agent who had a major restaurant that wanted to come into Newark. I won't say what it was, but there's one in Zanesville, one in Lancaster, and several in Columbus. City of Newark did everything they could to keep that restaurant from coming into Newark. Changing zoning. Changing this role, making you jump through this hoop. The restaurant finally gave up. Not even Myers. What are we doing to bring business into Newark? That would be money.
John, I don't know the specific situation that you explained with the restaurant owner, but I could say that investment of which we're occurring, which all of us are seeing with the roads streetscape and everything happening downtown, in our downtown area. I would say that working with the county economic development director, working with the Newark CIC, and I think all those things are trying to attract businesses and companies into the city as a team effort. And so, what exactly the administration is doing with that, and I don't see anyone from the administration here to directly answer that. So, I know that we as a council have supported their efforts through legislation as far as giving community development block grants to the Newark CIC and other things like that. But let's let this gentleman speak. He hasn't spoken yet, and then we'll go to some of the repeaters.
My name is Ron Wicker. I'm a taxpayer and live here in Newark. I'm happy to see some of those citizens talk about the service delivery, quality issues, instead of the dollar signs. I was somewhat appalled after watching the council three-hour session that the only thing we talked about was the dollar signs. I was also just, I have to say, impressed with your professionalism and handling the meeting. I thought the city administration, specifically the safety director, was not professional for you guys. And that means a lot to me as I listen to somebody try to tell us what's good for us if they're not being professional. And I was appalled, quite frankly, at that. Hats off to you guys. But we need to talk about the service and not just the dollar signs. The reason that I think it's most selfish that we ask part-time young people, and I'll call them kids, just compared to myself and the fire chief and a lot of others, these young people to attract in those positions are kids. So we're asking these young kids to come into our city and serve us. In a city that only has 14 firemen on duty, which is not safe at any standard. It's not safe for me if I have a fire in my house. It's certainly not safe, and I'm not calling these guys union guys. They're firemen, they're professional firemen. They're not labor, they're not union guys. They're just firemen doing a job. We're forcing them to come and negotiate, to beg for staffing so they can do their job. But what's most fair about talking about part-timers, and what's unfair? And ask Delaware. They've tried it 2 or 3 times and failed over there every time they've tried it. Other cities have tried it. There's tons of research and research projects and schooling that show a lot of the flaws with the part-time staffing models. But what I think is most unfair about asking these young kids to come in here and do this for $10 or $12 an hour is that Newark is a town with a lot of demands on public safety. I understand the issue of keeping fire trucks shining when you make a few runs a day versus the number of runs that they make now, the fatigue factor. What we're asking these young kids to come in here and do is serve us, take the risk of dying in a fire or being shot or getting hit by a car, things that happen to firemen and police officers and public safety. We're saying come in here and serve us because we want to save some money in what we pay you, but we don't want to give you any pension benefits. And the pension benefits is your protection. These guys have their protection. The chiefs have the benefit of this protection. And without that protection, I think it's selfish to ask these young kids who are going to run here for the experience to do it. There won't be any problem hiring people. It might be a problem of the training that it takes to get those people up to speed and that sort of thing. I just think for us as citizens to say, we want you to come and protect us and get shot at or get hurt or maybe be exposed to a flashover in a fire. I've seen a best friend of mine in burn, with his head the size of a basketball in a flashover fire. Most people have never ever seen that. It happens. That young kid that's coming here has nothing except his $12 an hour and his workers' comp coverage. He has no pension. So that's what we're asking these people to do. We have all kinds of reasons why we don't want to budget. It's not a revenue problem, it's a budgeting problem. We have a city that isn't electing to budget the money that's needed to run the fire department. Public safety should be the number one item in the budget. Then we deal with everything else. So that's all I have to say.
I'm sorry.
I don't understand something.
I understand that.
Yeah, speak loud.
My name is CJ White. We just moved to Newark about 3 months ago from St. Louisville. Excellent fire department out there.
Is it a lack of money to the whole budget that you're looking for someone to take and get some money from for the rest of the budget? Or is it just the fire department alone and EMS alone are losing money?
No, I would say it's an overall issue. I mean, we really are.
So it's to our city. Where you get the money from or what you do to get the money doesn't have to be the fire department. It doesn't have to be EMS. You just need more money in the budget, period, right?
All the city government has faced losses, yes, and then it does affect the district.
There are places and things that this city government could do to bring in money and chase it away, because this kind of maneuver will chase people away. If your town's not safe, people aren't going to live in it. You're already losing your factories to China. My husband lost his job to China, and we lost our home. You can't exist this way. You can't have somebody be afraid to live in a town and afraid that somebody's not going to come when they need them. And that's back to humanity. Everyone equal. Like she tried to say,
amen.
Everyone equal. Doesn't matter your color, your race, your creed. Somebody's going to be there to help you. And it takes a special kind of people to do the work these guys do. They're not run-of-the-mill guys. They're guys willing to lay their lives on the line. He's got nuts. We have a revenue source in this city that we're not utilizing. You've got landlords out there that you could charge a licensing fee and straighten up a lot of problems that way for people in the community.
There's one coming. There's one coming.
People that have slum houses and places that the city's having to go in and pay to either mow their grass or to take care of that place, or go to in a fire because the place is burnt down because it's not safe. It shouldn't be the county paying for it. It should be the property owner that's paying for it. And they should be charged and made to pay for it. Mm-hmm. And you'll see a stop someday. You'll see your beautiful city become a beautiful city. You'll see it become a community. Mm-hmm. And I can't believe that there's so few people here. I'm shocked at the number of people that are in this room. This is a big city, mm-hmm. compared to where I'm from. Place I was from, St. Helens. I mean, it was small, but we had more camaraderie than what I can see going on in this place. There's a lot of things wrong with this county, and it's not the fire department, and it's not your police department, and it's not your EMS. Those are the things you need. Those are the backbone of the county. You don't mess with the backbone, because the rest of the body don't work without it.
Thank you. Well, before I go to Mark, let's put up, she mentioned a way to generate more revenue is the rental registration, licensing. Mm-hmm.
Licensing.
That's what you, that's what.
And collecting from landowners who are not taking care of their property properly within legal.
Did you get that out with that other summary bullet?
I'm sure there's a better way to say it.
Okay. Let's see. Neil hasn't spoken yet. And we'll, I'm trying to get some people who haven't spoken yet, so. Oh, I'm sorry. You're. I'm looking at you. That's
okay.
My apologies.
Doug Lawton, 18-year resident of Newark North End, and one of your proud Newark firefighters. Something that the council unfortunately has to consider, and you guys have the hardest job, in my opinion, because you have to listen to the public. We have to listen to the public when the call comes in, but you guys have to listen to the public every day when it comes to certain things such as finances. Young lady here, she already hit on one of the ways to generate money. In this city, the citizens that work and live inside this town, that work inside this town, pay 1.75% tax income. If you live inside the city, but you commute outside the city to work, you get a tax credit. How much money would that tax credit generate if we eliminated it and made everybody inside the city of Newark pay 1.75? I pay it in 1.75. My wife, who also works inside the city, pays 1.75. We talk about what's right and fair across the board. This is what's right and fair across the board. It is something council seriously needs to look at. Now, I'm not saying hit these citizens immediately with all the, what I've been told is up to 0.75%, So we can incrementally put this into play over the next 3 years. This will generate revenue, and you've done nothing more than eliminate a tax credit. This is going to affect people, but it's going to affect less people because for a lot of us, I'm already paying full fare tax. So I think across the board, as a resident of the city, you get to call 911 the way I do, you get to drink the water that I do, you get to drive on the roads that I do. So everybody should pay the same tax. Thank you.
Alex, let's put that bullet point up, eliminating the income tax credit. Mark, you had your hand up. Go over to Gloria.
I just wanted to say, Jeremy, because I think this young lady brought up an important point up here. And, you know, we could have a meeting just like this for multiple departments of city government. I mean, the police department is way understaffed. I mean, they've lost close to 20, as of the firefighters, in the last 10 years or so. Streets, they have lost a lot of employees. And so there is a result to our inability to fund all these services. And it begins eventually to impact services. And so, I don't think we, even though we're here to talk about this issue, there are several areas of services in our city that are impacted, right? You know, the city administration has asked council to consider moving our police dispatch to the county. There's a lot of pros and cons to that. And one of the things I think we can achieve, especially if we can do something like try to delay a decision, get this thing into the bargaining where it belongs, we can put thoughtful consideration into this. I mean, just like the study from the city of Piqua, and you can Google that, you can find it and read it. I think all of us, not just us on council, but even citizens, can look at some of these studies and assess. I mean, because one of the things they look at when it comes to part-time firefighters is the turnover rate. What does a part-time firefighter want to be someday?
Full-time firefighter.
They want to be a full-time firefighter. So, what are they going to do? They're going to, the first time there's an opening in Reynoldsburg or Whitehall or Zanesville or Columbus, they're going to apply for it. And by the way, our starting firefighters, they're sort of at the bottom as far as their annual pay. So you know, there are so many things that we should look at before we jump on something like this. And you know, I'm not going to be on council next year, but I'm going to be a citizen. And I'm going to continue to voice the way I feel about these kind of things. We have to be thoughtful when we make decisions like this.
Gloria, you got your hand.
Gloria Smith, I live in Newark. To answer your question about the tax thing, I work in Columbus, and I pay Columbus taxes. And that's why I pay a little bit less. I also pay taxes to the schools here. So I'm paying to Columbus, I'm paying to Newark, I'm paying to my schools. So I am paying taxes, I am supporting my community, and I'm here today. And I'm also here to say that elections have consequences. And if y'all don't vote and pay attention to what's going on, from the state on down to local, this is what happens. People in Columbus make decisions about your police department, about your fire department, about your roads. So, every election counts. Every election is important. The election we have to put these fine people back supporting us, these fine people here from council that are taking time out of their busy life to be here to listen to us. We need to pay attention, we need to vote, we need to come together to make our community better. Not just today, complaining about this and hopefully finding a solution, but every day. If you really care about your community, you'll be out there working for it every day.
Irene.
Your suggestion about the income tax, something that amazed me when I retired was that I paid no income tax to the city of Newark. And I think that there are a lot of people in my position who could afford to be paying a percentage of income tax. And I would say that the city should do some looking at retiring, it's almost like nobody thinks you have any money. And I know that there are retirees who are living on Social Security. That would not be taxed, because the federal government doesn't tax it, nobody taxes it. But a lot of people have investments, pensions, funds that are just free and clear when they reach a certain age. I think the city should look into taking a little bit of that money. The working people, when I was working, there's a lot of expense to working. And so I'm not sure that it's a good suggestion, but I have one too. So I think that has to be looked into. People in my age bracket aren't paying any income tax.
I think the municipal income, you're correct, the municipal income tax doesn't tax certain retirements and
it doesn't tax any retirement.
So there, let me get to my point. But I think that those rules are governed through Columbus, through the Ohio Revised Code, as to what we can look into it, but I don't think that we can choose. That was the reason why when the mayor came for us last year and said, let's go for a property tax, I was vocal about going for an income tax, because the income tax did not tax retired citizens. So, but I think that decision, when we had that discussion before, was what incomes can the city municipal income tax collect on was a it's state that takes what we can collect there, but we can look into that. So
that goes to what Gloria says, that a lot of our consequences are because of decisions made in Columbus.
Yes, sir.
My name is Rusty White. I live here in the North. One point that I read, and I know it's true, you can verify or you can change it. 26 years ago, we had the same number of firemen as we do today for the city of Newark. That's what I said. So we've got a lot more houses, got a lot more people, we've got a lot more area to cover, a lot more traffic for the same number of firemen from 26 years ago. There are two ways that people generally jump on in order to get more funds, and that is cut off their heads or raise taxes. That's the fast, easy way. You don't have to think about that. Somebody else is going to have to cut the heads. Somebody else is going to have to raise the taxes. And that's the ideas we come up with. We need to come up with a little better ideas than cut the heads and raise the taxes, because neither one's really going to work. Well, one idea I got, and it's a hard nail to pound. The city government has a lot of departments. Those departments, at the end of the year, a lot of them have money left over. And what they do with it, they spend it on whatever they can spend it on, because they do not want to turn it in. What happens if they turn it in? They're afraid their budget's going to be cut for the next year. That money, if you could convince them that their budgets will not be cut, if they turn the money in, if they get this money, turn it in, and let it go to places like the fire department, the police department, wherever it's got to go, and rebudget the money. But don't cut them because they turned money into you. Just go ahead and accept the money and move on. And if the next year they need more money, then give them more money. But you can't just cut their throats. But that's another way of generating some money that's already there, but it's not taking it from somebody. And that's just my thoughts.
Go ahead. And then I'll go to David after.
Yes, you.
My name is Callie, and I want to thank all the firefighters and the public service. Y'all do a good job. And it really hurts me to hear, that they're cutting y'all back on part-time, because I know if I was a firefighter, when I got hit by the fire, I want to go home and go to sleep and get ready for the next day. And they got to understand that you all go out in the community every day and put your lives on the line, and you have to go through something like this. Same at the police officer, it's not right. And I tell people all the time, our community is just as good as we make it. Our students just as good as we make it. And we all have to work together. And I don't, this is just a comment that I want to give to you all. Because like I said, a great example of you all are listening to the young generation. I hear, no, I don't want to be a firefighter. Because when you want to go there, you want to put your life on the line, and you want to get something back. Sometimes you don't even get respect. Don't even thank you. So I'm thanking you all from the ones that don't say thank you and the ones that put your life on the line. Because you all have families like we do. You all have the same situations that we do. You all go through the same thing we go through. And like I said, if I was a firefighter, and if I did that part-time job, I would not want to go to another job. I want to rest and recuperate because sometimes you are going to things that it's not a good thing. And it's five, we lose firefighters every day. Every day. And then you sit there and look at you all in your faces. No, when you walk out there, they'll say about the police officer, you may not come back. That's a hurting situation. You have to sit here and go through something like this. I don't think that's right. So I just more or less made a comment. So. Thanks
for coming to the party and keep it a good work. David Green, Newark. I just wanted to follow up actually on that. I want to thank the firefighters as well. I think, and my wife thinks too, I think, that you, I'm never quite sure of that, but that you all have saved my life by coming to take care of me when I was in trouble. I think that people on City Council who fought to get state money back to the city have done an admirable thing. It's a very important thing. We lost money. The city claimed to have a surplus budget. I mean, the state claimed to have a surplus budget, and we were cutting programs left and right. I also want to say I think it's really valuable to have meetings like this. Somebody raised a question about it. But I think the more input you get from the community, the more solutions you're going to get. And it's a bad mistake to underestimate the creativity, energy, and power of the community. It's a serious disability when you underestimate that. Because you miss out on ideas and possibilities that you didn't even think of. Because we have 60, 100 minds in this room. That's way better than one or two people or even city council sitting together and saying, well, what are we going to do, and what are we going to do? We've got to deal with this and that, or even the fire department or administration. So I think somebody suggested the idea of a levy, and I don't want to beat this to death. I just want to say, every time I've heard that word, somebody says, oh, no, you'll never get it passed. Well, part of the reason why that's true is that it's hard to get levies passed. It's not just because people are having a hard time today, and they are having a hard time. It's because of the image that's created about the fire department and other things. The newspaper presentation of this and the presentation by the administration has been very strongly that firefighters take advantage of their time, they're sort of lazy, they take extra shifts, they do this and that, you know, and that it makes it seem like the community should not support working people. And I think it's also a mistake. I think we need to change that whole direction and say, these are honored workers. These are people who serve the community should be honored and respected and rewarded. I don't mean they should get rich and drive fancy, you know what. But, you know, they should be people who we say, all right, you know, you're doing what's needed to keep this community going. And so I think we should honor them. And I think if that was the atmosphere, then a lot of people would say, we need emergency help. We need fire protection. We need adequate stuff. You know, what? How much will this cost? A little bit more? Well, it's worth it. You get what you pay for in this world. I don't care what anybody says. Countries that have improved their social service system, sometimes they're criticized, and they have higher tax rates sometimes. But they get services. You know, they have transportation for people. We don't have transportation. They have a bunch of other things that we should take a look at. And I think that's why a levy is not out of the question, and I just echo that, just support that.
Yes, we have spoken. My name is Corey Conrad. I'm a Newark resident, and to follow up on this gentleman's comments, if you'd like to avoid a levy,
I have two revenue ideas. One would be asking a commuter tax, like this lady pays in Columbus, for people who don't live in town but who work here. And the second, I would ask you to look at possibly fire impact fees from local businesses, because I know that a Walmart or an Applebee's creates a lot more fire risk than my home does.
Saw another hand up. Was there another hand? Go ahead.
I just had another thought too. You know, there's other ways to save money in the budget. It's, you said something earlier about landscaping to draw businesses to the area.
All the downtown stuff.
Yeah. Well, even something that little has to cost quite a bit. I don't think that's really what you need to be doing. I think what we need to be doing is we pay guys to mow, right? The roads and stuff. Instead of having grass there, why not plant ground cover that doesn't need to be mowed? That's drought tolerant.
Exactly.
Then we don't have to pay somebody to go mow it. Maybe somebody trim it once in a while, but go mow it and then. So you're saving money. There are a lot of things that can be done. And the one thing you don't want to do is send it to some committee that's going to pay somebody a bunch of money to tell us what they think we ought to be doing. You really need to get the word out more to the people and get serious to the people in this county and this city about what's going on and get them involved in our county government and city government.
Just to clarify, the downtown stuff is more of a water sewer separation project than it is just the beautification on the upper level. So I just want to make that clear. It's not just, we didn't just spend money to make things beautiful. The main project is the water sewer
stuff. But if there's a dime being spent, beautification should be spent. I'm not the only one that said that. Everybody I talk to says, it doesn't need beautified. It's nice the way it is. Leave it alone. One-way traffic around the square has worked for over 100 years. Leave it alone.
Yes.
When the gentleman was so fired up, excuse me, unintended, about the overspending on the police building, I am a landscape contractor, got that in South Carolina. When you over budget a bid, like you go in there and bid your man hours, you cost your man hours. And that's where some of the, all your calculations covered that were in within the city budget. So I went in and underbidded several other landscape contractors and won my proposal and so on. So sometimes if you overbid your contract and you overbid, you got to eat those hours yourself. So you got to get your, you know, three gals and I, we got to go in there and we got to eat those man hours up ourselves. So we got to bite the bullet and so on and so forth. So with that overspending of that, where the gentleman was the overspending of the cost of the building, the police building or other buildings for new fire departments and stuff like that, if it's over budgeted and you've got that extra money and put it back in that reserve that you were talking about, a reserve that can't be touched for the next year, that would be a greater, if it's not stripped away from you by Columbus, you know, our biggest commercial, our main source where our voting goes to, but that's where, you know, other folks could be saved. And I agree with you, the ground cover. I know all the ground covers that, you know, are drought tolerant that could be planted in and beautified our corridors and so on like that. I brought this calendar because I know this is getting ready to close. For you firefighters, and I love quotations. This one has to do with March, since it's past March. It's by Mark Twain, and it says, it quotes, "The two most important days of your life are the day you were born and the reason you find out why."
Oh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mark Twain. Thank you. Your services are greatly appreciated, and it's based on altruism. And by far, getting a job is one thing, keeping it is another. And so while some of you may be retiring, as new ones are being trained, those ones may not work out, and if they get that opportunity to get a full-time job elsewhere, you have to be able to readily fill that other position, and they have to be extremely qualified for to fulfill that position as well. So we do want quality EMTs, firefighters, and so on and so forth. So keep that in mind as well. Thank you.
Something I wanted to throw up on the board, we have gone for about an hour and a half, and the library is open for another hour, so if people want to stick around, they can. But before we start wrapping up, I did want to add on, we talked about EMS billing earlier. Right now, the city does a soft EMS billing, where if someone has a bill, they'll send out a few letters a few times to say, hey, pay your bill. Hey, pay your bill. Hey, pay your bill. But if the person doesn't pay their bill, it's not like we're sending them to a collection agency. So being more aggressive with collecting EMS billing, I'd like to put that up there. Yes, sir.
Can I just say one more thing?
Yes, sir.
I offered some opinions, but no.
Yeah, go ahead.
Mount Vernon, which is a town I'm very familiar with, they have a mayor council system just like we do, but they have a combined safety director and service director position. Well, why wouldn't we consider that and freeing up that salary as a half of the firefighter's salary? Because we know in Newark that we have as good of a fire chief and as good of a police chief as Central Highway could possibly have. Why don't we do all that? All that either a part-time safety director or a combined model like Mount Vernon and a lot of other small cities use. Thank you. Yeah.
I'm Joe Kennedy of Nevada, off of Sharon Valley Road. I think we don't have a plan. Newark does not have a plan. If we say, well, where do you want to be in 25 years, it's kind of like, if there's nothing, there's no looking beyond. It's okay, we got to make this budget, whatever. We're not looking towards the future. We're not looking towards what can we do to keep our kids here. We're not looking towards providing the jobs in the future. We're losing the Rockwell/Meritor plant out there. I mean, how many thousands of people worked there a few years ago? It's like, well, they're gone. Longaberger is almost past tense. And I look at the history of this place and the people we produced and the ideas and the products and the industries, everything else that's been produced, it's mind-boggling. We don't seem to be nourishing that right now. And I think we have to really sit down and look and say, you know, this is the leadership of the whole community. Some look, what are our positives? Okay, we got some pretty state-of-the-art schools. We got a vocational school out here that's pretty tremendous. We've got new fire stations going on. We got a new police station. We don't have any jobs coming in to go with them. I think we need to sit down and figure out, all right, where do we really want to go? What do we want to do? And quite frankly, I think part of the solution's got to be, okay, let's grow our own. Okay, let's do what we can do to try to look internally, to help new businesses start, to produce the kinds of jobs that we want that are going to be long term, like MPW down here, that's local. What do they just announce a big new plan to expand the number of jobs there? They started locally with a pickup truck and a power washer. Okay? If you look up and down the line and you go back and you look at history and you see the kinds of businesses who started here, you know, the Englefields and that. I'm thinking off the top of my head, so I'm not hitting them all by any chance. But we need to be looking at that and have some kind of a goal so that later on, we have these kind of guys that are in, still continue to be in leadership positions and trying to rebuild for the future and do what we can so we have a plan so we're not constantly just looking down at the tops of our shoes and saying, well, where's the next step going to be? We've got to be looking on down the road. And that's going to take some real thinking by all the people around here. What do we want to do? You know, right now we've got some new lands that are available for development. What are we doing to bring jobs into Newark, Ohio? Okay, who are we working with? One idea has been floated a number of times has been, well, maybe we need a now the term is escaping me, but it's basically, it's to provide a growing ground for new businesses. Well, kind of like a think I'm sorry the term is escaping me. But
business incubator.
20 years ago, other cities and towns are doing it. Mount Vernon did it. Lancaster did it. Athens did it. Of course, Columbus has been doing it. to create and help our local businesses thrive, okay? And to help them nurture along. A business incubator, ta-da! Thank you, I found you turn that. Okay, business incubator, okay? And a really interesting thing happened this past year, all right? The Zanesville Business Incubator announced its award for the top new business of the year. Okay, top new business of the year, one that's really developing. Guess where it's from?
Newark, Ohio.
Newark, Ohio, that's right. They're developing software systems that'll help every apartment or rental project in the country and all the people use that, and it's starting right here. Now that Zanesville's helping them get up off the ground, where would you put your business? Okay, your hometown has kind of said, well, we don't worry about you. So it'll probably go to Zanesville. But I think we really need to be out there and looking and seeing what we can do to help those entrepreneurs that are out there and the ones that have always been thinking about starting a business and helping them go so that 25 years from now we can look back and say, wow, what have we done here? And, you know, you raise one boat and they're all going to come. So we really need our leadership to look down and say, Newark, where did thou goest? What are we going to do? Okay? And if you get down and get some thoughts going, you'd be surprised at what will happen. But we need to get going and really start thinking about tomorrow and not just tomorrow in the calendar, but when the kids entering school today are ready to graduate. And let's look towards our future, and then these problems will start to look pretty minuscule.
Thanks, Joe. And something I've heard you say is, and we went through several years ago, was a Destiny 2020 comprehensive plan. So maybe even redoing a comprehensive plan might be, not exactly, but maybe fulfilling it, those goals and things. Because that process, I don't know how many of you were involved with that process, but it was very rough. And then the other thing I want to say is Network for Rentals is on Union Street, the second ward. So thank you.
I just kind of want to float off what he was just talking about. I think that there's so many, like talking about the fire department. The fire department is not by itself in town. The police department is not by itself in town. There's a cause and effect. There's many entities that make up our town. And I think we need to start thinking about like tax base. That's one thing I'm seeing. We don't have enough money. Well, if we had better transportation, that could help our people get to work, we'd have more tax base there, which in turn could add more to the police department, more to the fire department, keep them safe. But everybody is just viewing each thing as it's all by itself, and it's not. It's like we can't have a tiny police department and a great big fire department or whatever. You cannot survive on 14 firemen from 26 years ago. Is that what it was 26 years ago? And now there's still 14 firemen. This town is much huger than it was 26 years ago. That's a give me. It's because everybody's right here. We're not helping our people get back to work and getting that tax base in, which will make our city grow, and that includes bringing business in the area. We need to be more lenient or aggressive going out there and pulling them back here. You have to solve a couple different problems, bring our tax base into our place, make our people healthier, make our families healthier. Everything, just like a domino effect. You know, if one doesn't work, something else is not going to work.
Thank you. Let's, people who have not spoken yet, good.
Desiree Blake, I live here in Newark, and I'm a big human person. I work with widows, and I just want to thank you guys, and behind you guys, human-wise. And part-time, I don't like, because if we had part-time over there at Owens, it's a mess. Because a lot of them I see going over there, which I can see here, you're going to train these people, the city's going to pay these part-time people to get trained, next thing you know, they're going to be gone. You know, so you don't need part-time firefighters. We need full-time. And if we had a budget to hire so many, how many people are we supposed to have right now with the budget we have?
The budget council approved was up to 78 versus 72.
So where is that extra money? Where is those people? You know, if we got a budget and plan, hire what you need. And then go from there. So where is all that extra money at? You know? We do overtime over there too, because they're on the budget, but we still got our full employees also, you know. That's the same thing. Hire your full-time people before you even think about part-time. You got that budget money in there? Hire them, and then go on from there.
I think Everett hasn't spoken yet. Do you want to make a comment? Is anyone else after Everett who has not spoken yet? And then we'll get to Mark, and then we'll wrap it up here. We just want to make sure everyone has had a chance to speak.
Yeah, I've heard all kinds of great ideas here, and being a complex problem, any one of them is not going to fix the problem. It's going to be a combination of all of them. And also about bringing in new businesses, why do we need to bring in businesses? We're sitting on a business called farming. Newark is not a farm right now. We do have a few small farms, community gardens around, and they're great. We have one farmer's market that's open 3 hours a week. How do you imagine, how can you possibly even get there at that time to buy this stuff? Now, it could be that they don't have enough produce for any more time than that. I don't know. Maybe you could answer that. But what we need to do, what's the most important industry on the planet? It's food. Food production and distribution. Without that, we couldn't exist. But yet, that's one of the farthest down on the list that we even consider as being a business. We could create the Newark being a farm, not a town of farms, but a farm. We have a lot of land area that's going to waste, basically, planting grass, pouring chemicals on it to kill the bugs and the weeds. That's ridiculous. We could take that same area, or even a fraction of it, and grow more food than we could possibly use, and even export it and make money on it. That would be a business. We have people running all over the place looking for something to do.
We don't need more exports. We need imports. We need jobs in America.
We need American-made.
American-made.
That's right.
Not China. Right. You can't find something in Walmart. It's called faded glory, and that's what America's become, faded.
Right. So, you know, we could be a self-supporting and at the same time, you know, export our goods, not to China, to other communities around it. Don't do this yet, or whatever. But like I say, we have people that are looking for jobs. That would be their job. They would be farmers. Everybody could be a farmer, so at least to some small degree. I would be more than willing to let most of my land go for that purpose, and I've already indicated that. Right now, there isn't enough manpower to do that. Well, why is that? We get very easily, and it doesn't have to be profit-making to start with. Anything that starts up usually doesn't make a profit to start with. You have to have people that are willing to put their time in to make it work. But food cannot fail. It's a business that cannot fail. It's impossible. So why not take advantage of that? And take advantage of the natural resource that we already have. So there you go.
Thank you. Mark,
Oh, Don has his phone here.
From looking at your numbers, it just looks like to me, and I've been trying to do some figuring here, and I know the chief's optimistic, but I think if we get somebody hired by October, we'll probably be lucky. If we could hire three that we're talking about that we get on the SAFER grant, and three more than we have budgeted for, that would give us 78. That would we probably still, if we could keep overtime at 3,500 like we've been doing, that would still give us 78 and give us probably some surplus at the end of the year. Next, I don't know if 78 works, but 78 is better than 72. Mm-hmm. The next issue we have, of course, are the raises for next year and the 27 pays. And the balance of budget this year, nobody's mentioned, we took two healthcare holidays to balance the budget this year, which is about 280,000, 300,000, but there's 2 months each. I'm not sure we can do that again next year, depending on our self-funded healthcare. If we've had a pretty good year, maybe, but maybe not. But I at least think we ought to, certainly as a council, try to push to get to that point for the end of this year. He's a perfect helmet, and everybody wants more firemen. I mean, everybody in this room, everybody at council, I know want more firemen. Everybody wants to be safe. That's not a problem. It's just how can we do the best we can with the money we have. That'd be nice.
Thank you, Don. Has anyone who has not spoken who wants to speak here?
I'm Eric Lee from North Ohio. I just think about what or are you going to do anything to try to alleviate some of the fear and anxiety from the seniors in like Brandenburgville, you know, Washington class, that don't take a lot of comfort in not having a fire station in the East End. Mm-hmm. That's their perception. It means a lot to them. I mean, it's comforting knowing that you have a, regardless of the response times and all that, just knowing that you have a fire station in your neighborhood is.
There was somebody that said something earlier here, and I don't remember, get what you paid for. I'm sad, that sounds terrible. I don't have the resources there. I have to think about the people in the Washington Square Apartments in those areas there are covered by the downtown station. The numbers speak for themselves. I cannot put people in a fire station that has very low call volume when I have another fire station that is constantly out and mutual aid covering them. I have to put those resources there. It isn't a perfect scenario. We are doing the very best with the current staffing levels that we have. I don't want anybody in the city to feel unsafe. And I'm sure Chief Connell, the police department, feels the same way. That's why I'm here. I care about it deeply. I talk to these gentlemen, I talk to everybody in the fire department, people in the public council. I'm trying to find a solution to the problem. We need more people, bottom line.
I'm sorry you may have misunderstood what I was saying. Actually, all I was seeking is that we communicate to some of the seniors in the building that we do have these in cover sufficiently, and that they have no need to worry or have a high anxiety because they don't have a fire station. Maybe an IP or informational tablet or something, or just somebody that goes to the building and says, you know, this is what's happening with our fire coverage in the East End. We may not have a fire station in the East End, but you can rest assured that you'll be taken care of when you become.
Among the everyday articles that Ken Mallett is posting about the fire department and the umpteen public records requests that I provided, there was something in one of those articles in regards to staffing at the East End station that I said that they are covered by the downtown station. Hopefully the people will trust that what I'm saying is fact. You never, in this business, in the fire department, you never know what's going to happen. In the city of Newark, if we have a house fire, most of our units are tied up on that fire because we need all 14 people. If there is a second emergency somewhere in town, you're probably going to get somebody from another district. A mutual aid may be waiting for help. That is how it is. That's no different than any other municipality that has just enough people to cover. I don't know if many of you read the paper, we have quite a few fire emergencies in Newark per capita. As comparatively speaking with other cities our size, we have more fires. Our firefighters do more firefighting. We saved 3 people from house fires last year. There's many communities in that are our size that don't do that. We are top notch. We need more people. As a fire chief, I feel responsible to do everything I can to increase the staffing. And I work with the mayor and the safety director, and we have these conversations every single day. I'm in City Hall. who talk about increasing the fire department. We need it. And he hears it from the police chief. And he hears it from, they get it from all angles and city managers all over the place. But I try to beat the door more than others. That's just how I am. So I don't want anybody to feel unsafe. Maybe you're right, and maybe we'll take a look at that, and I want those people to feel safe and know where their help's coming from.
I think you do.
Did I answer your question?
Just that anxiety.
Or at least I just...
It does, and I don't want to give you the impression that we don't know our firefighters and we don't back them 100%.
You know, I don't think the community does. I think we talk about this in the kitchen over coffee before our next run. We do talk about this. Does our community support the fire department? If some things you read in the paper, you think, oh my gosh. I think there's a very small percentage of people that have a larger voice than the majority who love us. And because we provide a great service. I've seen it with my eyes for 23 years. These guys do too. Some things you never hear about that firefighters do for the people in the public, putting an elderly woman's groceries away from an auto accident we take to the hospital in her car. We go to her house, put her groceries away for her so they don't get ruined. No one ever hears about those things, but we do those things all the time. We really, really do. They're fantastic people. I really like to have more of them. I would, I just need to get there somehow.
I think
hold on a minute, ma'am. Okay. Paul, you have not spoken yet today, so did you want to make a comment? And then anyone else, because we do want to wrap this up here soon. So anyone else who has not spoken after Paul, let's get the people who haven't spoken yet. Go ahead, Paul.
Paul Moran, resident, activist, historian, City Hall doorman, here in Dallas. I do attend city meetings, council, and the committee meetings. And there's a hot issue. There's only 12 to 15 residents that show up year-round for the meetings. And these folks that are on council can all verify that. And there's enough room, but if there's a big issue, it's packed house. So generally, it's just 12 to 15 people. There's no unity in the community when you have that kind of turnout. You're not going to hear or you need to be heard from everybody. You're just getting a little portion from those few that are there at the meetings. Now, if financially, if things get worse for the department, would we be looking at going to an 18 or 12-hour shifts? If the financials get worse, would the shift schedule be changed or anything like that?
I tell you, we have discussed all kinds of options. Reducing what we currently have is not what I want to do. Let's just say that. Let's look and see what type of solutions we can have to continue the service and make it better. Mm-hmm. That's the plan.
Now, several years ago, there was the city and downtown association was looking at doing a business incubator. It was going to put on South 3rd Street where that farmer's market's going in, plaza, wherever it is. They went to that building for a business incubator, and it never came about at all. And if they were going to go in that direction, I think the John J. Carroll building would be an excellent building with Park National Bank as a partnership to have a business incubator. Because that building's sitting empty other than storage, that's about it. And that'd make a great business incubator. And also there's land downtown on the east side to have shopping centers. And it would provide people a way to work by walking. They wouldn't need transportation. We've got to bring jobs to the people so they can get to them. We hear about New Albany and everything, but they have bus service or train service. People can't get to them jobs. So jobs are meaningless to a lot of people. But if we had shopping centers here where we got space for, they could just walk right to it. We pay our taxes, so you get revenue and everything. I mean, I've been suggesting a couple of times about a downtown shopping center. There's room on South 3rd Street for one. And Everett Avenue could also provide a shopping center there next to this apartment. There's room for a shopping center. Across the old Conrad School, there's room. We just need to get people involved. We have a Lincoln County Chamber of Commerce. They don't care about the city. They took away our farmer's market from us this year. I mean, they don't care what's going on in North. They're sure about don't pockets and what's going on in Western part of the county. We need a group that's going to be focused mainly on North to bring progress here. And not just ignore or take away like the chamber has. Thank you.
Anyone who has not spoken, so everyone has had an opportunity to speak. Really want to appreciate each of you coming here tonight. The library is open till 8 o'clock, so feel free to talk amongst the folks that are here. Really want to thank you, Chief, for being here. Thank you. Obviously, obviously, as the gentleman said earlier, you know, Everett does record all of the proceedings at City Hall, so you can always watch the YouTube, I was about to call them movies, sometimes they're movies, but they're, the proceedings there, but it really was the feeling from that committee meeting, it was like, we're not getting the full picture here, so that's why I wanted to do this tonight, and I, the true colors and disrespect was just horrible in that committee meeting, and so that's one of the motivations of having this tonight, so I'm glad that you recognize that. But thank you all for coming here tonight. You know, we have another half an hour till the library closes. Feel free to talk amongst folks, and I want to just thank Alex for taking notes tonight, and thank you all for being here. Thank you.
Okay, before we go, can we give a nice round of applause for our public?